How do you handle and move an irreplaceable object such as a tall case clock? The approach to dismantling and moving a tall case clock will vary. At Winterthur, the reason for the move, whether the clock is a running or non-functioning clock, and the experience of those assisting determine how to proceed. Three people are normally involved when moving a tall case clock. The extra hands and eyes are helpful when maneuvering through and working in the museum collections. Moving two carts with clock parts through the collection can be complicated, especially when considering risks to other artifacts that are present. Handling, assembling, and disassembling tall case clocks require knowledge of the care that must be taken with these objects and experience with nuances unique to each clock. Tall case clocks on view at Winterthur include running and non-functioning clocks. A running clock will require a more detailed interaction with the clockworks when disassembling and moving the clock. Non-functioning clocks require the same care and handling, but often not the same preparation when disassembling for a move. To begin disassembling the clock, the hood is removed to access the works and assemblage. As is necessary with all objects, before we begin to work with a clock, we first identify vulnerable areas, such as moving and removable parts, and fragile ornamentation. Hinges and hardware become loose and fail due to generations of use in environmental conditions. Use caution when opening the hood and waste doors.
Is that sometimes these hinges have worn to the point where they have failed and the door actually sits just loosely. You want to be sure that that's not the case prior to removing it. In this instance, the hinges still work. So.
But as you work with old clocks, always be aware that with temperature change and wood shrinkage and movement, things can get loose and cannot remain where you expect them to be. We discover that the lower hinge on the case is being held in just by one pin, actually not even by a screw. And the weight of the door, if I weren't supporting it, probably rip the top hinge out as well. And so you always want to be thinking about consequences as you feel a little wiggle or something that's changing in a clock case.
Clock hoods often have finials and or a cartouche, and some have a sarcophagus top that could be detached. Make sure there are no parts to stabilize or remove before removing the hood. Clock cases having elaborately decorated surfaces are not uncommon. Use caution when handling and moving them. Before you remove the hood, notice how the dial is displayed through the glazed hood door, the symmetry and spacing of the dial. This provides a guideline when putting the clock back together. When all loose decorative hood elements have been placed on a cart and padded, remove the hood and place it on the cart.
It feels like it's sticking on the top.
Yeah.
Is it? Watch the sconce.
Yeah.
When grasping the hood, place your hand so that it prevents the hood door from swinging open. Open the case door, lift the left weight off the pulley, and place it on a cart and pat it. Do the same with the right weight. Check to see if the clock works is attached to the seat board before removing the pendulum.
So you don't want the clock to do this when you remove the pendulum.
To remove the pendulum, grasp the rod directly above the bob and lift the suspension spring off the hanger, out through the crutch fork, and move it out the case door. Be aware that the suspension spring is very fragile and will easily bend and break. Place the pendulum on a flat level surface, for example, the flat cart that will be used to move the clock case. Grasp the seat board and lift up the works, allowing the pulleys to clear. Place the works on a cart and stabilize with foam or sand snakes. A tiered cart, such as a Rubbermaid, is used to transport hood, movement, finials, weights, and winding key. A flat cart is typically used to transport the case and pendulum. Secure the case door with twill tape if it cannot be locked. Have in place a quilted packing blanket or pad on the handle of the cart. When moving a clock case having ball or bracket feet, do not allow the weight of the case to be carried by the feet. Put a rolled pad under the base to bear the weight of the case. Place the seat board and works on the uprights and replace the left weight. Be aware that the pulley often comes off the cord or chain when the weight is removed. Reset the pulley on the cord or chain so the hook from which the weight hangs is under the pulley and the cord or chain is uniformly seated in the circumferential groove of the pulley. When the left weight is in place, return
spring
the pendulum
through the crutch and then the block into the crutch just high enough so that we can get the suspension spring into the its hanger. Okay, just a second. Interesting.
Return the time weight. Due to the caution that must be taken when working in and maneuvering through the museum environment, minimize materials and transport devices when working in the collection. Have available materials that can be used with a broad range of media and for a variety of applications. Materials that are commonly used include swatches of fabric made of knit, flanneled, or felted cotton, and archival tissue. Both are good for padding and stabilizing. Polystyrene foam and shock-absorbing polyethylene allow in-situ application for supporting and isolating objects. Painting blocks and sand snakes can be used with a variety of objects to stabilize, isolate, and support them during a move or for temporary storage. To move a running tall case clock, first its works and assemblage are removed, as previously demonstrated with a non-functioning clock. We begin by raising the weights or winding the clock to make the task safer and easier. Winding a running clock is performed routinely, allowing regular checks of the mechanical assembly. An 8-day clock is wound weekly, and a 30-hour clock is wound daily. The winding crank, or key, for winding an 8-day clock is often kept inside the clock case, and the holes for winding are on the face of the clock. Normally, there are 2 winding ports for raising 2 weights, or 3 if there are musical chimes. A 30-hour clock will have a rope or a pull chain for winding, as demonstrated here by Bob Hogue. Bob Hogue is the former supervisor of the Winterthur Collection maintenance staff, and following his retirement in 2010, after 40 years of service, continued as a volunteer at Winterthur, winding the running tall case clocks in the collection.
And I'll wind it a quarter of the way, and I'll take a peek and see.
Hogue recommends that one carefully observe the following points when winding a tall case clock. Plan to wind the clock when the winding holes are accessible, and not obscure it behind the minute or hour hand. If you must move the clock hand to gain access to a winding hole or to adjust the time, use this approach, keeping in mind the clock hands are extremely fragile. Move the minute hand only. Move it clockwise until you hear the click of the strike mechanism.
And you'll hear a click. That click's the beginning.
Pause to allow strikes to complete. If necessary, continue in the same fashion, slowly moving only clockwise, moving only the minute hand. Beginning with the left winding hole, insert the crank and turn clockwise to raise the weights to within an inch from the top of the case door. Observe the cords when raising the weights to see they don't become tangled and that they are winding correctly on the drum. Some drums do not have grooves to guide the cord. If the weights have been removed from the pulleys, the cord will become loose and possibly get tangled in the axle, a very difficult problem to correct. If the cords happen to be made of braided steel or brass, clamp the cords above the pulleys, close to the bottom of the seat board, to prevent them from coming off the drum and becoming tangled in the axle. Note the condition of the cords. Look for frayed or weakened areas. Do not overwind the weights by raising them too high. The height to which the weights are to be raised is indicated in many clock cases by a chalk line on the back of the case. Raising the weights too high impedes access when removing them from the pulleys. It makes it very difficult to place the weights back on the pulleys. And it puts undue strain on the mechanism.
So the same thing on the right side. And you just put your hand and you keep turning. You see it.
If the clock is not keeping accurate time, adjust the pendulum bob.
You can make that adjustment with the pendulum. And that little brass round piece there, there's a screw at the bottom that you can loosen up and it drops down and that'll make the time go slower. Or you lift up on it and you screw it up a little tighter and it'll make it go faster, whatever it's needed. But normally you would check that in the middle of your 7 days. Normally check it at 3. Because
when the weights have been raised and the pendulum adjusted, if that was needed, the hood, assemblage, works, and case are secured on carts for transport, just like the non-functioning clock. Reassembling the clock. To reassemble the clock, first set the clock case, then check the level on the front and side of the case. A clock must be level for it to operate properly. So it's pretty important to keep them level, to keep them...
Keep them level. They won't run without being level. It just won't happen. It'll stop on you. So.
Shims are often placed under the base or feet of the clock to help with leveling or to prevent the clock from rocking. A shim under the seatboard might be necessary as well to adjust or fine-tune the level reading. The practice of wearing gloves when handling artifacts has broadened since the arrival of nitrile gloves. Cotton gloves have a reputation for diminishing tactile ability and snagging unstable or textured surfaces, and often the option was to have just washed hands and forego the gloves. This is still the course taken when handling some media, for example, textiles and paper. But now, when handling all metal objects, including fragile clock hands, nitrile gloves are always worn. When handling and moving tall case clocks, it's helpful to know basic terms identifying the assemblage and case parts. Beginning with a case, usually there's a single board called the backboard that runs top to bottom of the case. At the top of the case are uprights and the waste molding. The dial, also called the face, and movement, often called the works, are attached to the seat board, which sits on the uprights. The removable hood, also called bonnet, sits on the waste molding, housing the dial and movement. The weights and pendulum extend from the movement and are accessed through the case door, also called pendulum, trunk, or waste door. This is the fragile steel suspension spring that holds the pendulum in place. Seen here with its top in the hanger and as it passes through the crutch fork. Visually prominent in the movement as well are the gears and pinions and the winding drums with their axles, which must be kept free of cord or chain slipping onto it when handling and working with the clock. The 8-day clock will have 2 winding drums, or 3 if there are musical chimes, and the 30-hour clock has 1 winding drum. Donald Fenimore demonstrates the placement of the winding drum on a 30-hour clock. This clockworks and dial from the Winterthur study collection was converted at some point from a 30-hour clock to an 8-day clock.
Look at the location of these 2 winding drums, which are always present on 8-day clocks. They are not present on 30-hour clocks. 30-hour clocks have 1 winding drum. And you will see there is an empty hole right here in the back of the back plate. That's where the 30-hour drum was originally located. At some point in time, it was removed and these added to convert this 30-hour clock into an 8-day clock. 8-day clocks being more desirable, generally speaking, because people don't like to be bothered winding them every day. They'd rather wind them only once a week. So in fact, this clock is not what it was originally intended to be. And some would say it's defaced. It's a perfect study collection clock to point out the features that have been altered on it.